Good morning. I know a lot of you know who I am, but for those of you that don't, I would like to just tell you a couple things. I'm married to Les Blum, who's sitting where we usually sit. We are retired dairy farmers down by Cannon Falls, Minnesota. It's about 4.5 hours away. We kind of kid each other that there is life after cows. And what that means is nothing religious or anything. What it means is that when a lot of people that are involved in a family dairy operation, they don't have the privilege or are able to retire. And that wasn't the case with us. And so we are very blessed and happy to live up in the North Woods. We lived here about 3.5, going on 4 years. We've been a member of St. Andrews about 3.5 years. And I'm really happy to share God's word with you this morning. The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 24th chapter. The Gospel for today is from Luke 24, 13 through 35. This is the colorful story of Jesus' appearance to two disciples on the road to Emmaus. It answers the question of how Jesus is to be recognized among us. Here he is revealed through the scriptures and in the breaking of the bread. Reading from the Gospel of Luke. Now on that same day, when Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene, two disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were walking with each other talking to each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and then when they did not find the body, they came back to us and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them to the things about himself in all of the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it's almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road While he was opening the scriptures to us, that same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen. He has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been known to them in the breaking of the bread. Let us pray. Lord, we ask you to help us understand your word and to live by it day by day. In your risen name we pray. Amen. I kind of summarized the scripture in 4 points. The first one is, there are two travelers that are met on the road. Second, they have scriptures read to them. Third, they share in a meal that reveals and the presence of Christ. And the fourth, they're then sent to live and share the good news. But what touched my heart after reading the gospel about this scripture were the four words that pop up in the middle of the story. Four words that I think are among the most heartbreaking and realistic in scripture. They are, "But we had hoped." The disciples had hoped that Jesus was the one that would redeem them from Israel. That was their hope. That was their dream. They said, "But we had hoped." There's so much said in those four words. It talks about a future that is not to be. It speaks of a dream that created energy and enthusiasm, but did not materialize. A promise that created faith that proved to be false. It speaks of a future that is closed off, now irrelevant, but dead. It will never happen. Ernest Hemingway was once challenged to write a short story in 6 words. This is what he wrote: "For sale, baby shoes, never used." It's not just the tragedy of what happened that hurts, but the gaping hole of all that could have happened, but won't. I want to tell you a story of a 10-year-old boy that was being tucked into bed one night by his single father. Before the young boy says his prayers, the father and the boy talks about things that went on during the day, such as school things, good things, maybe some bad things that happened during the day. The young boy paused and said to his dad, "I wish I didn't have to go back and forth from mom's house to your house, from your house to mom's house. I wish I had normal life. I've only had a normal life for 5 years," as that's how old he was when his mother and father got divorced. His father, of course, was brokenhearted, as he also wished his son could have a normal life. They cried together. The father then said, "You are so blessed to have a mother and father that love you so much. And you know what? Jesus loves you even more." That's all he could tell them at that time. The son had hoped. The father. The scripture says, "But we had hoped." hoped. Those heartbreaking words just tear me apart. But you know what? They're so true. They are not the only truth, of course. There's much in life that is beautiful, that is confident, inspiring, and much more, all of which deserves our utmost gratitude. But there is also disappointment. There's heartbreak. There's failure. And all too often we tend to gloss over this. Well, maybe we don't gloss over it, but we feel that we need to have some sort of resolution for the situation. I myself struggle with that concept. I'm a fix-it type person. I found that if I shut my mouth and listen and share my compassion, instead of trying to solve the problem, in reality, I'm letting God solve the problem. And isn't that what it's all about? Does this sound familiar to any of you? A friend shares the news of the death of a sister, and we sympathize for a moment before we change the topic. Or a colleague shares her disappointment at not getting a promotion. And we remind her, well, at least you got a job. Or we see an acquaintance we know has just gone through a dreadful loss. And we avoid him or her altogether because we don't know what to say. We don't mean to be callous or insensitive. We're just at a loss with loss. We feel inadequate to confront the darkness of our lives and the world. So we flee to the light, only in denial. In the church, with these feelings or ways we are thinking of are sometimes harmful. And maybe that is somewhat understandable. We are, after all, people of the resurrection. And so when reading this story, we often hurry to the burning hearts part of the story, celebrating with the disciples their encounter with the risen Christ. Why is it that we feel that we can flee the cross-like experiences of life and skip to the promise of resurrection? It's not just a church thing. It happens every day of our lives. But just as we believe, before there is a resurrection, there is a cross. So we also believe, before there are burning hearts, there are broken. Let me ask you this. Can we be a place that welcomes broken hearts? I'm sure you're saying, well, of course, we can welcome people. But I'm not talking about treating our broken hearts as a means to an end. You know, let's acknowledge the cross so that we can get on to the resurrection. No, instead of talking about recognizing that part of a human being is being broken. And that is human. And it is to these broken-hearted disciples in today's reading and in this Sunday's worship that the risen Christ comes. He's walking along with us on the road. Surprised that we don't see him as we ought. He's teaching us scriptures that we should understand and then sharing his presence through bread and wine and giving us burning hearts that brings us back into the world. You know what, friends? It all starts with broken hearts. And our job as fellow Christians and as ministers of Christ is not to get people to admit their darkness or to own their hurt. If they're not ready to do so, they're not going to be persuaded by you or by me. And the ones who carry this with them daily don't need to be convinced, only invited and allowed. Invited and allowed to share their disappointment that the cancer returned. Invited and allowed to share that the addiction was not overcome. Invited and allowed to share that their beloved died. Invited and allowed to share that the job didn't materialize. Invited and allowed to share with his dad how sad he was that he didn't have a normal life. They only need to be invited and allowed to grieve a future that will never be, in order that they may possibly hear and receive the future God has created and prepared for them, when they are ready to hear it, as they are able. That, you see, is what happened to the men on the road to Emmaus. Jesus was listening and comforting them. Then he took bread, he blessed, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. That's when their eyes were opened and they recognized him as their Savior, who died on the cross and rose again. Perhaps this Easter season we can make a little extra room for the brokenhearted, trusting that the Holy Spirit will set their hearts afire.